Yeah, you know that.
So last session we were discussing on query designer properties. So we have seen a couple of properties in query designer. Then the main part I wanted to show was this navigation attribute, how that is reflecting. Let's open the query again. Now the navigation attribute, if you remember that day, for sold to part, for ship to party, we kept country as navigation attribute. So can country itself has have some master data of its own? Like can country be loaded separately with its own attributes, with its own master data?
Yeah.
Obviously. Okay, so first of all, what happened was this ship to party, whatever country details are there, when it was a display attribute, it was not storing anything. But when we made it as a navigational attribute, we saw that master data tables got filled. That countries tables were filled with US and UK, the two values of. Okay. Now what I did is, okay, of a separate load to country, imagine. Now, previous query, let us see. Okay, so if you see the country is shown as a individual characteristic because it is a navigation attribute, it comes out as an individual characteristic and you can do navigation with it or filtering, anything you can do on this. So that's why we were able to drag and keep country separately. But address can be kept only along with ship to party. Individually, address cannot be used in the report. Like if I want to drag address, ship to party comes along with it because it's a display attribute. But for country, it is not the case. It is behaving as an individual object. Only country is there. Okay, this is the advantage or the difference, what we can say. Now, let us run this report. So initial output, ship to party and address will come. But country can be used in further navigation. And that day we created a variable and we said that if we enter anything into the variable, it would display that output. We are giving more flexibility to user. Now if you check this variable, double click this, the variable is configured as not mandatory. Let's see over here. Variable is optional. Optional means whether I enter that variable or not, the report output will come. But if I make it as a mandatory, compulsory, I have to enter the variable. So let us see this. It's possible to change. We'll change. I'll make it as a mandatory. Likewise, we see that the value is not coming. User should select this and then from the list it will find the values, list of possible entries for that field. Now sometimes what happens is, even though this option is there, this pop-up option is there, but they refer to of customer a particular value frequently, so that value can be put in default values. So when the first pop-up comes, this default value will come along with that. Since they frequently use this, sometimes they run the report with this, or sometimes they modify the mandatory and I have added a default value. I am saving this variable. Okay, let us check now. Let's reflect. I saved it. Okay. Now we will run the report again. So this time it gives a pop-up with a default value and also mandatory. So you can see a default value is coming. This is mandatory. So this, whenever in variable screen, if you come across anything like this star, that is a mandatory. Now if I remove this, for example, I want to bypass this without giving any values, system would show a message. Specify a value for variable because it is mandatory. Earlier when it was optional, system would allow you to proceed further. So this is about the other properties of the variable. So that's why the processing type is manual input default value. Either that you can input it or you can set it. Now, country they have put in free characteristics, right? Free characteristics. So,
Ravi, I think Arvind, I think we cannot hear you.
No, I'm fine. I can hear him.
Oh, you can?
Yeah. Okay. I'll put it as I'll copy this into another variable. This variable is allowing me only a single value. That's why. Okay, I have kept this new variable. It is now giving me multiple of possibilities. So if you see over here, it is representing an interval. Interval means between. There is another option, selections. A variable represents selections. Not selections, something else. Let us see. Variable reference selection option. If you select the selection option, then you will get greater than, less than, those possibilities. But if you select only as interval, you will just get between. So the topmost I have selected 151, the least one I will select so that it covers the entire range. Now check it. Whenever you are entering anything, you first check it. It will validate whether the entry is correct or not. Then click on OK. Okay, now I drill down according to country. So why we are unable to see anything for country? Country values are not showing up. Coming as a blank. Can't see. it is coming now properly. So this one is country is US. Next country is US, like this. All the countries are kept properly. Now the other discussion we had last class is we were unable to filter anything on the display attribute. You can still check on address. I don't have any option if I select a filter. It's showing me customers only in the selection, but I cannot choose based on address. But for country, I can choose all the available countries. It is behaving as an individual object. Now my point is, country has four values. But why is it not showing four values? Why is it showing only two values? As per our data, the corresponding countries are US and UK. Through some other data, the Poland and Germany were loaded. But why Poland and Germany are not being shown over here? Why only US and UK? Understanding that point?
Because the shift to party range that you selected?
Or can I say for this, these are the only customers link, for these ship to party,
yeah.
Only these countries are linked?
Right, yeah.
Okay, there is some aspect which is working. So what that aspect is, if we checks sold ship to party, after adding this navigational attribute property, one table will come, attribute SID table. In this table, in object, it's SID and the SID of values in the country. Okay, so you see this. Now, let me see this. This is the SID table of shift to party. It will contain SID and characteristic value. So let us see what's the for SID for 151. The SID is 6. Okay. Now, this is linked to US. That US SID, what it is? That US SID is 8. Okay, so this ship to party has SID 6. Corresponding to this, the country SID is 8. So that information is captured in this SID attributes table. So for 151, the SID and the corresponding country SID is 8, US. So that is how, what it is doing is, when you are doing further drill down or further analysis, it is using the values in this table, what all are link, all the links are provided or maintained in this table. In this table it is maintained that these all customers are linked to only US, UK. That's why only they both are coming. Poland and Germany are not coming. Is it clear?
Yes.
System is maintaining this kind of integrity check because of this SID attribute table. SID attribute table contains the link between the main object and the navigational attribute. That is, it contains SID of main object, characteristic value of main object and the SID of navigational attribute. Okay, this is how it is behaving. This is the property of navigational attribute. Now we have, I told you there is one more attribute called compounding attribute. Compounding attribute is nothing but during DSO, I told you account is linked to chart of accounts, profit center to controlling area. So source system dependency we are achieving via compounding. If you want to recollect, it is nothing but zero account PC, it is compounded to chart of accounts. This is nothing but an attribute only. So that's what we have already. Navigational attribute of navigational attribute is called transitive attribute. We will see this. So if you have zero employee that is having so many attributes, one of the attribute is person. What kind of attribute person is to this employee? Yes.
Zero employee.
Navigational attribute of employee. Can I say like this?
The person is right.
Because it clearly shows it's a type navigational. Okay. Now this person itself can have many attributes. What is its gender, what is its country, like that. So person is having so many attributes like location, country, date of birth. Now I'm talking about gender or nationality, let us say. Its nationality is a navigation attribute. So what is the link between zero person and zero nation? Nation is navigational attribute of person. Okay. But now what I want is, what is the link between employee and nation? So what I can say, nation is a navigational attribute of person, which itself is a navigational attribute of employee.
Yeah.
So that's why what I can call nation is transitive attribute instead of saying navigational attribute of navigational attribute, a single word is it's a transitive attribute of employee. Clear?
Yeah, indirectly. Right?
Yeah. So, like this, in reporting level, we are able to see only one level, like an object, its attribute. Like if I am using employee, in report I can see person only. The other attribute can't be seen. If you want to see this kind of attributes and all the properties, if you want, transitive attribute can be made use of only in reports on InfoSet. So only in InfoSet you can find this link from nation to person, employee. Rest all things, it is 1:1 between an attribute and its attribute. So these are the different types of attributes and other things. Now, we have already loaded the DSO last time, and again now it has recreated it back for us. So
it is under Navi.
Area. So this chain, was it the topic? That's where we stopped, I think, right?
Right, so we loaded it.
Did we create the chain or?
We just loaded up to DSO, that's it.
Okay, like info, yeah, I thought of showing you chain, but it didn't work out, I think.
Or reloading the file, that's what you're talking about? The chain?
No. Just
we started this, I guess, but the chain that
yeah, correct. So I'm just how to create it. Basic steps I told you. Yeah. Just basics we were about to create, but we couldn't create it.
Right.
So now we will create it. So the base, the T code is RSPC in order to create. So the main goal is successfully we are loading the flow. We are working with the flow, but I want to automate the flow. So in order to automate the flow, I go with the process chain. So you can directly click over here or type the transaction code. Then just like for all our objects, we have a folders. Even for this one, it should be a properly organized, like finance chains, sales chains, master data chains, transaction chains, like that. So directly, I cannot create a chain. Either I have to create a component, that is nothing but a folder, or under an unassigned, I can create it. So let me create under unassigned. Or you can create a component also, as you wish. Or you create under unassigned, later on you can create a component, whichever way you want. Okay. First I am creating some folder, under that I am creating a chain, or I can create under this one itself, under unassigned. So give the chain name process chain or DSO. Now a chain should have a start time and start, right? So that start time is called as a start variant. You have to create it. Start variant for DSO. Now, is this an independent chain which runs, or this is dependent on something else? If it is an independent, you give direct scheduling. If it is dependent on something else, you give meta chain. This is independent, and again when it should run, we have many options: immediate, date and time, after job, after event. So we discussed this in that session. So I told you an example that we are scheduling it based on some time, but by that time the file is not there in the server, so the load will fail. If user sends the file after some time, then again we have to fix it, only then it will run. We have to repeat the chain, load, then only it will run. Or user will send file sometimes early, but the chain is running as per the schedule, but they want to see the data immediately. Again, so many issues are there. That's why placing of file is called event. Once event is generated, it will trigger the chain. So event-based chains we call. So that is what we decided. Ideally, it would be like that. But for this time, I am making it as an immediate. Save it. So immediately, the chain will run. Now, what should be the next step? Just think about the DSO loading process and tell me the next step. Shall I add create DSO, or create data source, create DSO, those steps, or?
No, right? It's already there, right?
Yeah, they are only one-time activity,
yeah.
Creating objects. Then what do we do regularly? Like if you are the one who is manually running it, what do you do daily in order to complete the load?
Just daily file upload, right? Just only run a
info package.
Info package and the DTP, right?
Right. So user will keep on sending files regularly. We like if user sends a file to us, we will manually run info package. Is DTP, but since it is automated, those steps we have to put. So here you have options, load process. These are the different process types. Whatever manually you are doing it, most of, almost all of them you can achieve automated. So that is shown as a process type.
How about from active queue to active table? How that we were doing manually, right?
Yeah, correct. Yeah, so that we also we have to add the activation step, DSO activation. So that is a correct point. So just to drag it or double click, it will show a pop-up. Now, sometimes we are creating variants, sometimes we will access the object directly. Now, in this case, we don't need to create info package. Our info package is already existing. If I create a variant, it will take me to creating info package. Or I need, don't need to create a variant. I already have it. I already have the info package ready. So just to go and search for the technical name of info package. So directly take this, now find that info package from list of info packages. You can confirm based on source system, all the data source, everything you can check and confirm. Now you can see automatically it has brought DTP, it has brought DSO activation step, everything it has brought.
Oh, just entering the info package? Or data source?
Yeah, correct. So the reason why it has brought this thing is, first of all, there is no ambiguity. There are no multiple DTPs. So it knows that it is associated to a single DTP, it will get that DTP only. Okay, let us see that. Okay, if there are multiple DTPs, then it would have a, it would still throw a pop-up which DTP you want. Okay, and moreover, why we have got this automatic is, here we are having an option, default chains. Default chains means system is automatically suggesting the process. Since we are learning stage, we will tell system do not suggest anything, so that we can only add the subsequent steps. So the subsequent step would be DTP. So take the technical name of DTP. Again, do I need to create a variant or just have to select the existing DTP?
Or just select.
In this case, just select it. So there you would be confused, like sometimes you might require to create variant, sometimes you are directly choosing object. So after few days, like once you practice, you will have a clear idea that why it is like that. Until then, it's just trial and error only. You would see whether you can directly access or whether you can create a variant. So now the next step, as you said, DSO activation, where it can be, under which process type folder it can be. There are many folders over here, right? Under data target administration. Activation of DS. So now in this case, are you directly accessing it or indirectly accessing DSO? If you just select the radio, the option list of possible entries by clicking F4, you will not see the list of DSOs over here. Some variants are shown. So for this one, you have to create a variant.
So we have to create a DSO again?
Or no,
data source. Data
just
source.
We are creating nothing. We don't need to create anything. We are just trying to indirectly access it via a variant.
Oh, okay.
So variant, in short, what you process variant, what you can understand is access object indirectly. So in that case, we were accessing info package directly, so that's why we used to know, we didn't use any variant. DSO. Now you choose the DSO. This is our DSO. Save it. So you are using a variant to indirectly access the DSO and activate it. That doesn't mean that info package and DTP step over here, they are not variants. Even they are also called as process variants only. So now you have to organize them. So what would be the order? Can you tell me first what should be there, then next?
Data source.
No, among these things. First should be start variant, right?
Right.
That will trigger your chain. Now, after that, first my info package should run. Then DTP should run, then DSO activation. Simple. Correlate what you are doing manually.
But the last one is activation. Okay, okay.
Now, it is saying only. Correct. Correct. So now it is saying when I am linking info package to DTP, it is giving an option. When should DTP run? When info package is successful, failure, or whether it is success or failure, DTP should run.
So successful, right?
Obviously successful. There are some cases like deleting index, creating index. Those are not that critical steps which should stop a chain. So those steps can be run always. They are the cases where you will go with a situation always also. But for this, mostly you go with a successful issue. Then again, DSO, DTP to activation, successful. That only. That means again internally they are all triggering. First of all your chain is triggered, then again start is triggering, then that will trigger this, this triggers this, like this. Now activate the chain. So just my chain is active now. While designing or doing anything, if the shape is not proper, you just refresh it, it will come to a proper shape. Then I have to schedule this to run, right? So I have an option over here, schedule. It is asking for job priority. No need to mention. Priority A means others, like if there are limited work process, this one will be given more priority, and this one will be ran first and other will wait in queue, like that. The priority, but it doesn't matter in system. If you keep everything as high priority, again it will cause some bottlenecks. So let it leave as a standard priority. According to the availability, it will run. Now my question is, we are scheduling it now. When will it run? It will run based on the option we gave in the start variant. Since we gave immediate, it will run immediately. If we would have given at so and so date, we are scheduling it now, but it will not run it. It will be in a released version until that time and date. Once that date and time arises, then only it will run. That aspect you have to understand.
So if so the time is not, is this, if it's run immediately, it means it will not run again, right?
Correct. So then again, good point. So if you want to run it for the first time, you are setting it up. Subsequent runs, how it should run, if you want to define that also. Over here you have option periodic. Then you give the periodic values, whether it should run hourly, daily, weekly. Or any other specific period, any 2 months, 5 days, 4 weeks or 3 days, like this. So what happens is, after this time, like we are giving some date and time, after it finishes for that time, again a job will be released, and when the next period, next frequency is achieved, at that time it will be running again. So it keeps on happening. That is about the periodicity. Now we have to monitor this thing, right? So there is a T code RSPCM. Can see no chains entered. Should all chains that do not have a higher level can be entered? Yes, it is speaking of the chains. Okay, still you see that this is the for the first time. This is the first time we are calling this one. So it has given us the option like this. Later on you are creating one more chain. Let us see. I'll copy this chain. my point of copying is, why I copied is, I wanted to show you, first time it is capturing all the open chains and showing it, later on what it does, that's what. The same start variant cannot be used for two things, so that's why system is giving a message. It gave a red message, if you see this. Some other variants like the DSO activation, it can be used in n number of steps, but this start variant is unique for a chain. That's how the system is keeping a trace of all the chains. So what I can do is, now all this we are having three different views. We are having a planning view, we are having a checking view and log view. Planning view means we are designing object, we are changing it, creating it, all that, you are scheduling it. Log view means after it executed we are seeing the log, and checking view means whenever we are activating at that time we can check what is the, whether it is properly designed or not. So while activating it went into checking view. Now I am unable to modify the start variant, so that's why I go to planning view. So each view has its purpose. What I am able to do in planning view I cannot do in checking view, the same I cannot do in log view. Exchange variant, so just now I have created a variant, right? So you can choose that one. Now activate it. So our aspect is whether it will refresh or not. So slash n rspcm. It has not brought that new chain. So refresh all chains. It has not yet brought. So in that case, what to add it, you can choose like this, that button, you can then subsequently whatever, so the, for the first time itself system is taking from the available list and it is refreshing it, from subsequently whatever you are creating you have to add it to this monitoring screen. Okay, now you can see this is the main DSO which we main process chain which we created. It is inactive status, or no status is there because it has not run. So let us run that now. So if I have to schedule it, then only it will run. And in the start variant it is set as immediate, so it will run immediately. Refresh, if you refresh anything, but if you go to log view, you can see what is happening. In the log view, you can see these all steps finished, this step is executing. The same you can see over here also. While executing, if you click this, it will take you to the view. The DSO active. Evaluation is still learning. So that is what I wanted to stress, that what you can do in planning view, you cannot do in a log view. So in log view, you can see everything in that monitor over here. It shows that it pulled data. Likewise, DTP also, you can see the monitor. Need not go to the object individually, from here itself you can see it. Target administration you can do. Go to the manage screen of the DSO. Okay, now you refresh it, it would have completed. It's a relatively small chain, so it got completed. So here, after it completes, status will be there. A means active, but since it completed, when log, which logs you want to see, system gives that option also. Since it ran today only, and giving today's option, so you can see after completion, the log, it is green. G means green. Green means successful. So like this, a chain is scheduled automated. The monitoring team is monitoring it via RSPCM. Now if I want to reschedule it again, because I have not put any periodicity or any frequency, I just want to reset it, reschedule again, I have to go to planning view. In that view only I can do this scheduling. Okay, just to refresh it. You can see it became like this, status was yellow when the chain was running. After chain completed, it became green. So that is what the team would do. They can't go and check each chain. This kind of transaction is there, or in a company, some other transaction code they will use. They'll use a transaction code ST13. That also shows like this only. So, but we can't use that. It's not configured in our system. In a real introduction, real systems, they will configure it. It will show all the list of chains like this. What they do is, let me schedule this again.
So there is no notification if something fails?
Correct. So that is also there. I will show you how to put the notification. Okay, now you see. They keep on refreshing. The support guy who is working, his only task will be this. So you can see it is running. So what they do is they organize this in a pattern, descending order. So whatever is yellow will be there, then red, and then green. So whatever is green, they no need to worry, because obviously it's successful. Whether it pulled some records, how many records loaded, that's not a matter of concern. If something of that discrepancy arises, user will raise concern that data mismatch, then we can find out. But the support guy purpose is whether it's running or not. So if immediately, whatever failures will come, he will fix it immediately. Now, it just keeps on refreshing. If it is long for some more time, that is also problematic. You cannot leave it that it is yellow means it is in progress. Sometimes what happens due to some connectivity issue or some due to something else, it just keeps running. Because if you see the info package, there is the configuration in info package. Means whatever info packages you have kept in a chain, they will show like this. The reason why they will show like this is, this would make people aware that be careful while opening this. If this is opened while the chain is running, the load will fail. So by seeing this message, at least they will be careful that okay, this is in a chain. So whether the chain is running or not, whether I should open it or not, that they can see. Here you have option timeout time, 7 hours. So due to some issue, connectivity issue or any other issue, no data available, something issue also, it keeps on running for 7 hours. It tries its best for 7 hours. So imagine such a scenario has occurred. The chain will be yellow for so much time. So that doesn't mean it is running. So if whatever is, the guy in the monitoring team will have an idea that daily it is finishing roughly in 45 minutes, 1 hour. So if it is exceeding that time, he will get suspicious. He has to look into that and then fix that. Why it is long in yellow. That's it. Now, if any failures are there, immediately you will fix the failures. So let us see anything. One load is this one. It failed. Their task is to fix the failures quickly. That is why they are there. Because all the other loads will be, the data will not be available if these are not fixed in time. You can see it is giving some message that it ended with errors. Then I repaired it. Again it gave the error message. You will get more clarity if I click on log. Log will take you to the log screen. So we never know which kind of project you will be put You might be development, support, anything. If you are into support, then your day-to-day activity will be this one only. No creating of objects or anything. So you can see that this failed. It failed initially. I clicked on repair option. It failed again. So whenever it fails, you see this, we are in the log view. If you go to the planning view is not capable enough to handle this kind of issues. Like it doesn't show us what has happened. It is not total showing that in previous run so and so issue happened, nothing. Process monitor option is not there. Okay, now you go back to the log view. Log view is the one which gives you all the possibilities to fix. So here it failed. So let us see what's the failure. Just double click, it will give you the message. Messages, data record saved according to configuration. Not much we are able to understand from this. So you go to the process monitor, just like if you manually run DTP, then you will check the monitor for the issue. So that's why you have an option, process monitor. Go to that. So when it ran, this is how the monitor screen was, and it's causing some issue. So check the what is the message. Duplicate data record. Fine. So this is a master data load, I guess. And duplicate record is causing the DTP failure. Here also in the temporary storage view, you can see that these are the duplicate records. Clearly duplicate records you are finding. Why duplicate records are coming? Maybe it has processed two requests from PSA. You can see that's the reason. PSA info package would have executed twice, so it has brought two requests in PSA, that is causing the duplication.
Mm-hmm.
You can go to the PSA over here like this. Again, you can go to the PSA, you can see. But why it ran twice, that we have to see. Because you scheduled it via a chain, why should the PSA run twice? Why should the info package run twice? Just to see all the logs. We don't know when it was triggered, so you tell me. If I want to see this process monitor, it will show this particular execution. If I want entire executions, I go to the variant, I click on the monitor, it will show me when did it run. So we see that it ran twice on that day. So first run, was it normal or through info pack or through a chain? you can see a log is coming over here. So a process chain log box is coming. That means the first run happened through a chain. Okay, let us see which chain triggered it. The chain which triggered is this one, catch full P01. Note it down. Now go back. I think parallel scheduling happened. That's the reason the info package, the chain ran twice, I think. Let us see. Can't say twice because the log shows it ran only once. Maybe this object is there in another chain. That can be the reason. Like this, various issues you will be coming. So this one you take. This one ran through which chain? So we see that this is through a chain the parallel is since it got triggered in both the runs. If you check in the first time when it ran, the info package would have run. But somehow it didn't pass the trigger. This is also one of the case. If you see, double click. It should pass a trigger to the next one, saying that this as it says the other thing didn't get triggered. Okay, now subsequently someone again ran it, so again the info package ran, but this time DTP got executed. Earlier DTP didn't get executed, this time DTP got executed. Since two requests are there, duplication is there, it caused an issue. Now how to fix this duplication? In for master data we have to enable handle duplicate records, right? This one. You enable handle duplicate records, then you do I need to rerun entire chain or only this step?
Only this step.
Okay.
Did the whole chain get rolled back or just
the object is saved? rollback concept is not there because already data would have been loaded to PSA, right? Like if you want to roll back, you have to manually go to PSA, delete the request. Then you can run it again. But our aspect is this is a small load. If we rerun, also no problem. But in real world, we'll be having millions of records. Again, if you rerun, too time consuming. That's the purpose of having a PSA, right? To reprocess. So that's why. Just now, system is giving us an option. You can see in planning view it didn't give. In log view it is giving repair or skip. So I have to click on repair. So once you do correction and you repair, now this time it will execute, another instance will trigger. One more node would come beside this. Again it failed, oh, bad luck. So this time why it failed? Exception. Previous request is read. Obviously, if you recollect our sessions, anytime we have a read request, while loading manually, it will give a pop-up. Shall I delete the old request? But here it is automated, right? That pop-up will not having a support team or a support guy. He has to fix these kind of things. So let us run it manually. I'll show you what we'll get that option. You can see we'll get the option when we run manually. But while it is automated, we are not getting the option. And since last request is already there, it's failing. So what you have to do, how to fix this one?
Delete.
Delete the read request from the target. So that's why whenever we are fixing, you have to see head and tail, everything, that wherever the request got posted, all those things you have to see. You have to delete from all the places, then you have to repeat. Simple repeating will not fix. So now repair it. This time another instance triggered and it's successful. So you can see over here, for each time you are running, you will have a separate log ID. This was the log ID for first time. This is the log ID for second time of chain execution. Now within the chain, first time it ran this DTP, you will have an instance for this. In the last tab, you will have an instance. This is the variant name. Variant name is the DTP name. This is fixed. But instance is what request is generated. It is 30. Now here, next time when we repeated it, variant is same, but request generated would be different. Instance is different. So this is the meaning of instance and request variant. Okay, instance, variant, log ID. So sometimes if you know log ID, there is a T code, RSPC1. So in RSPCM we are monitoring all the chains. If I want to monitor only a single chain, RSPC1 monitor single chain. While monitoring single chain, if you have a log ID, fine. It will directly open that log ID and you can then analyze why it failed and you can fix it. Or If you have a chain name, you can give the chain name also. I gave log ID, it opened the log. Otherwise, if I just give the chain name, if I am not sure of the log ID, just you give it chain name, it will monitor, show you only limited to this chain only. Then again it's up to you. You go to the log view to see all the logs. Again in this log view, what logs you want? You want the recent log, it will show. If you want more logs, you choose the specific option so that it gives all the executions and you can compare. Okay, last time when it was successful, this is how it ran. This time it failed, this is how it failed. Like that, old logs will help you in analysis. So this is about the process chain and fixing. Some more issues are there related to process chain, and as you said, some alerts needs to be maintained. We'll see that in the next session.
Oh, next session, like, are we doing it Saturday morning or?
Yeah, ideally that would be better, I guess.
For how long? Is it like hour and a half, 2 hours? I cannot do more than that tomorrow.
Yeah. I would limit it to 1 hour and a half. I don't want to exceed also, because now itself we had a long session, so hour and a half.
So what time? 9:30 to 11 is okay.
Okay, a little early is not okay.
You mean 9 to 10:30?
Yeah,
we can do that.
Okay, but what would 9 be for me? Can you check at my
9 plus you're in Bangalore, right?
Yeah, Bangalore.
7:30 maybe, is it?
No. You are 9.5 hours ahead, right? So 9 plus 9.5.
No, it would be 6:30.
6:30.
Okay, 6:30 in the evening for me, so that's comfortable.
Okay.
But if you want to start it at little late so that it's comfortable for you, you tell me. Is it 9 okay for you? We will start at 9, or it's up to you now, because it that time is okay.
So that will be your 7, right?
Which
half
one?
Hour.
Yeah.
So if we do 9:30, like
you just decide at what time you want to start, whether it's 9:30 or any time.
So 9:30 to 11, if it's no big deal for you.
Yeah, no big deal. So it would be 7 in the evening, I guess, for me.
Okay.
Fine. So if tomorrow, any issue, I am free. I am not occupied by anything today. So due to this timing confusion, anything happens and I am not logged in, so Zafar, please call me.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.